I got this.
Oh.
calling yourself a coach. So dead.
Nothing personal.
Out of my way!
always with me. Hey guys, watch this.
Thank you.
ship. Watch this.
I've had a few too many close calls.
Mm-hmm. the ring of a bell comes to you on a cold wind. The ring comes again and again, until soon the air is full with the sound of a thousand, thousand bells ringing all at once. You are alone. And then, you are not. An indistinct figure stands before you, flickering between forms like a fire-cast shadow. A fixed, taunting grin. Bottomless black eyes. A yawning chasm in the earth. The aspects of Barith, the Usher, and the Pallid Knight shift in and out of focus. And at their back, four indistinct shades hover. You feel an eternity stretch out behind each of them, reaching back to places so distant and yet so near you cannot comprehend their size. The shifting image of Barith settles on the aspect of the Pallid Knight.
Watcher.
Her voice is the discordant clangor of gongs struck out of time.
I tasked you to discover Aethys's intentions. Tell me what you have learned.
The Pallid Knight knits her brows.
He does not seek to return to the Beyond? Intriguing.
Her sickly pale skin pulls tight across the bones of her face, as if the shell of this aspect does not quite fit the impossible creature it contains. The figure nearest Barith dissolves and reforms in the image of a thin-lipped ancient crone whose face has felt the melting kiss of fire. The goddess Wodica strides forward.
Does Aethys frighten you, Barith? He should. Margron subdued Aethys' influence once before, and yet he returned.
From out of Wodica's shadow shuffles a hunched, bald man you recognize as the god Scan. His skin is mapped with swollen lash scars, and breath whistles through the ragged hole in his face where his nose once was. He does not speak, but stares up at Wodica, with naked loathing plain on his ruined face. Wodica steeples her long, knob-jointed fingers.
We must annihilate Aethys now, before he makes a rash decision we cannot easily annul.
She casts a sly look at the Pallid Knight from the corners of her eyes.
A moon would do the job nicely.
Wodica throws her head back and laughs. The sound is a dry, rasping bark.
Andre could do with a new act. Her current one has grown rather stale.
They see to their own affairs. You will speak to them in time, should you have the need.
The figure beside the aspect of Barith flows forward in a swirling cloud of ash. The ash falls to the tiles and reveals a molten-skinned woman leaning on a monstrous, wicked-edged broadsword. Mogren's glowing lips curl in disdain.
We must find a solution to the problem of Aethys that is neither do nothing nor destroy the world. I acted in haste during the Saints' War. You will not goad me into doing the same now. To move against him while his plans are unknown would be the height of foolishness. We must find wisdom in precaution.
Mogren looks at you as one might a wayward gob of spit on one's shoe.
It is no business of yours what the gods decide.
Another of the silent figures steps forward, and the warm, golden light of a summer's afternoon spills across your face.
Let's all take a deep, calming breath. Perhaps cooler heads will prevail.
Behind Helia's words, you hear the soft coo of doves.
Aethys has been separated from us for too long. Isn't it possible he intends only to gather enough souls to reclaim his realm in the beyond? He should be welcomed.
You look up then into avian eyes. Through them, you see clouds of starlings converge and divide. Helia puts a feathered hand to her chest.
He wouldn't. Betrayal is not in his nature.
Scan shuffles forward.
Yes, yes. We should welcome Aethys's return to the fold. His gratitude we can leverage to cajole him into divulging his plot. Then, when he believes himself to be in our good graces, we do as Wedica suggests, and crush him into the earth.
Scan pauses, inspecting you.
Ah, and here is the Watcher who wiped dear desperate Ali's mind. You could have let my followers help her kill the man who tormented her. But you did not. Curious.
Scan licks the ragged edge of his lipless mouth and grins, then turns to Helia.
I did not expect such a deliciously ruthless idea from you, Helia. I am impressed.
Helia's feathered crest stands on end.
You wretched little creature.
Your point is well made, little Watcher. If self-evident, Aethys has not been known to possess a vindictive nature. Indeed, he has occasionally been magnanimous to a fault. However, if we push him to the brink of reason, there is no telling what he may do. He is, as ever, unpredictable.
Something akin to fondness creeps into her voice. The pallid knight gestures for silence.
Aethys cannot be killed, but he may be subdued. Yet to do so will take immense power and time. Both stand in his favor.
Magrin grits her black glass teeth.
That is why we must ascertain his plans before he has the chance to put them into motion.
She begins to pace. Her steps leave little trails of fire in her wake. Magrin stops and balls her hands into flaming fists.
Even if we manage to destroy his current form, there is the possibility he could return if he has not already absorbed all of his children.
The pallid knight casts a cold, cutting glare in Magrin's direction.
Magrin speaks too freely. That knowledge is beyond your ken, Watcher.
Wotica waves the gods to silence.
Aethys gathers strength. His strength is a threat to us.
Her voice takes on a sharp, almost panicked edge.
There is no sensible answer to the question of a resurgent Aethys other than decisive, final action.
Your opinion is unasked for and unnecessary, but noted nonetheless.
Though her tone is impassive, the banked fury in her eyes says well enough what she thinks of your interruptions.
We will act when it is appropriate to do so, and not before.
The pallid knight steps away from the half-circle of assembled gods. She pulls herself up to a great height. The words she speaks next come not from her mouth, but from all around you.
Follow him, Watcher.
The black of the pallid knight's irises expand until her eyes are as dark and cold as the void between stars. She bends down and brings her ghostly face level with your own.
Your debt to me remains unpaid.
She stares at you, unblinking. Like a needle drawn to a magnet, you are pulled toward her one compulsory step at a time. You blink open your eyes and find yourself on the floor of your ship's cabin, alone.
Let's just keep it. Spies? Let's do this.
My lord, what do you require? With Cadnua in ruins, there was little purpose in waxing sentimental over the rubble. I was able to salvage enough of your treasure and wealth to afford the purchase of the Defiant and the hire of a small crew. Unfortunately, that consumed the remainder of your once considerable assets. Under the circumstances, I hoped you would not object. I was the steward of your keep at Cadnua, my lord. Long before your time, I had my soul bound to a throne of Ardraban. And for nearly 200 years, I felt Cadnua and the comings and goings within it like an extension of myself. It is a strange connection to lose. Still, it would be unseemly for me to complain of loss to you, my lord. I suggest we proceed to Nekitaka, my lord. It is the largest city in Deadfire, and we shall be better able to get our bearings there.
The Children of the Dawn Stars. I wondered if we'd run into them down here. There's someone I used to know. Just an old friend. Came out here to settle with them last I heard. Maybe we should ask around. See if she's still out here. Might. All right. We used to, you know. She was real loud, too. Used to have to cover her mouth or she'd get the dog howling in the next room. I knew you'd understand. You're gonna like her. I got a good feeling.
Bilge swallow?
That's what be a bilge swallow, little lass. And it be a swabby fathom-headed enough to drink from a bilge.
You talk funny, Uncle Seraphim.
You know, lass, each time you call me that, you be aging me 3/2 a year. Ahoy, Captain. Truth be told, Ferrante half expects us to get our asses blown out of the water at Fort Deadlight. Fortunately for you, I have this bad habit of beating the odds. Of course, I do that by way of good old traditional chicanery. And the most important part of any horn swoggle? Solid planning. Well, that and surviving. Oh, I did say contacts, didn't I? Contact would be more accurate, in the singular. Alas, by the name of Ciri. Been running the same circles for years, doldrums and fair winds. We're never family, but never on the wrong ends of arms, neither. Might have shaken the sheets a few months back. Regardless of how she feels about me, there's no love lost betwixt her and Benwith, that's for damn certain. Yeah, she's sharp as shit, that one. Tongue, mind, and ears alike. Sailed out of Deerwood or Adir one. Knows her not, and how to crew a ship that won't turn sour. But words ring out among the Principi. More than you'd think for new blood. Part of that's a fierce support of freedom, from slavers, from the empires, from the Huana's caste system even. The rest are lenient hand. Step out of line and Ferrante's got your old crew up for lashes. Aldis, though, she's, now, let's say there's a reason she attracts limp-cocked nut-twists like Benwith. Can't say I much approve of a lack of regard for our traditions, but, can't say I don't share her vexations with Ferrante and the old guard, neither. Ah, the Principi's no fleet. More a mishmash of fiercely independent captains. Of them take to one another like sharks to krakens, but we be bound by the slippery slipknots of tradition. Even those back in tradition cooperate for protection against our enemies. Many of the old guard have died off, though, and the new blood flooding in be less the civil sort. Deadlight's a tough coconut to crack, but if not cracking, what are nuts for? If you insist on the straightforward approach, you could always load the old with powder and balls and hope the walls of Deadlight give before your hull. Here's hoping you've practiced your breaststroke, savvy? If you breach the walls, you still got the guards to attend to. Adding to that a mess of pirates in multitudinous states of insobriety. And probably dress. Aye, Captain. Looking forward to watching you work. Not to be Deadlight's a tough coconut to crack. But if not cracking, what are nuts for? Captain, look.
I'm always willing.
Not to be telling you your business, Cap, but if we don't set... Later, sure. Not to be telling you... And if you break... Aye, Captain. Looking forward to watching you work. Not to be telling you your business, Cap, but if we don't set sail for Deadlight, Benworth will finish his repairs at Paul Anchor. Later, sure, sure.
Did you catch the new play by the peg leg performers yet? It's awful.
The Green Menace? That I did.
Send me for a butter slicer, Hotsack. It's you, ain't it?
Angry by the thumbs. At your service, he says. I'll keep it quick, see? If your little dinghy has got some chase in it, I've got a list of captains with a black mark to their name whose ships need a quick scuttling. And I'm in the market for a scuttler. Saying you're not? Me? I hear you dive at coin like my second husband to the bottom of a cask. Never mind where I heard it all the same, eh? Word gets round faster than pox. So, we have a deal? Knew we'd be fast friends, I did. You'll be looking to scuttle Cornu first, one of Rautai's finest, eh? I don't ask my client what he did or what scale his death balance is. Safer to keep questions in the hold. Of course you will. Now's a good opportunity when you seize it. Cornu helms a Voyager early muster in the waters north of Nekataka and south of Sayuka. Avon? Better if you don't ask.
Fair day, traveler. Anything I can do for you, just say the word. Lady adventurer at your humble service. I was born in a deer and raised in the field, and there's nary a crevice of this archipelago I haven't seen. Aye, the living lands most off, but the Deadfire as well of late. And my goodness, if you think the Deadfire's wild, I must say, it's no more thrilling than a Lady of Luxury's afternoon luncheon in comparison to the glorious madness of the living lands. Being a cipher's come in quite handy, I'll tell you that. Oh, dear me, yes. Can't seem to avoid it. Not a lick of it's my fault, of course. It's the university. Always sending me to the most dangerous corners of Aeora, the skimps. If I didn't know better, I might say they were trying to kill me. There's not other way to rid themselves of a tenured professor, after all. Oh, aye. Some you wouldn't right believe. Like the time I lost part of my ear here, see? Lost an entire research team along with the ear. Rather a long day, that was. My colleagues have implied I might be cursed, but I can't say I much agree. It's just the nature of the work, you understand. I mean, goodness, if you want a lady to find you the rarest plants, you gotta send her to the most remote places. On my last expedition, my colleague Innes got herself lost looking for what was essentially a big prickly weed. No medicinal use at all. I found her, though, mostly intact even. Blessing from the living lands, I call it. But I do go on, don't I? Travel quick, travel quiet.
That's easy.
fresh fruit, vegetables, dried goods for long voyages. I got it all right here.
What can I stock you up with today?
Disaster of epic proportions, if ever I directed one. A typhoon couldn't have cleared out our audience faster. What's wrong? I'll tell you what, everything. My troop's coming apart at the seams. We're short on cash, we're low on people, and we've run plumb dry on enthusiasm. We haven't drawn a decent crowd in more than a fortnight, and it ain't like pirates are hard to please. That's how you know the show really stinks. But I think I know what the problem is. We've got a lack of flair. If only I could hire more talented performers. I just know my play would take off. Really? Well, that's great. Then we could... Wait a tick. Why would you help me? What do you get out of this? Right. Beggars can't be choosers, I suppose. I'm in desperate need of two more performers. A wizard for one, plus any oaf big enough to pose as Aethys. I happen to know a wizard of the finest skill set who already performs here in Dunwich, Tiana at the King's Coffin. But unfortunately, I got no idea of where we might find a suitable Aethys. Get me the right people for the parts, and I promise you'll be pleased with your investment. I'll turn us a profit or die trying.
My old captain was a drinker from the day he was born to the day he died. Always he was rail thin. He wound up with a wooden leg, 26 ships and a bilious fever.
My good sir, hello. Whatever might I do for you? I'm certain there's no need to tell you, observant as you no doubt are, that I am an actor. Stage, tavern, street corner, they are as much my home as where I lay my head at night. So I travel Aora, looking for opportunities to share my gifts with the grateful masses, wherever that may lead me. Oh, goodness, yes, loads of it. I've been known to joke that I'm less a man than I am a walking bank for all the coin that I carry. The common folk do so love an actor. We bring mystery and excitement to their otherwise dreary lives. Yes, you could say we're doing the God's work. I'm truly gratified that you think so. It's quite difficult, you know, living as I do. On occasion, foolish folk will take my act for reality. I've thrice been run out of a town for impersonating a foreign dignitary. Damn fools don't understand the blistering wit of my satire, I tell you. I had to learn to protect myself as a result, though I must admit, what martial skills I've got aren't of use for much more than fighting off wolves or throttling a thief with designs on my satchel. Thank the gods, I hardly ever need to use them. I could talk myself out of nearly anything, you know. Well, thank you. I must say it's gratifying to be recognized for one's talents. All things being equal, I'd much rather recite a sonnet than swing an axe, but a man's gotta make his way in the world any way he can. I would be honored, but a man needs to make a living, you know. So, for my services, how about 3,000 copper? You know where to find me if you change your mind. May luck accompany you on the road, my friend.
Sunrise is a world, doves. The coming horizon. Sea-sized room. They sail on wooded brigs, and they wail to us. Put down anchor. Breed and don't loot so much. But when should we lot? Where and how could we settle? Drink some more, doves, and you may sober up, sinking Aora's last ship, 3 stars before the burning. The morning is a blight, lovesome. The morrow is a pus-filled boil. Welcome to the treasure trove, sailor. Anything in my trove catches your eye, you let me know. All right.